One of the most intriguing artifacts from Paleolithic Europe are perforated batons. They are found across Western and Central Europe and date to between 40,000 and maybe 15,000 years ago, roughly, rough dates. An absolutely huge span of time, roughly coinciding with the height of the last ice age. For a long time, archaeologists have wondered what they were used for. Were they symbolic, maybe a symbol of power, or were they practical, a tool to help people survive in the last ice age? Let's find out. This whole video began the other day when I got an email from one of you guys. Hi, big fan of yours here. I just wanted to let you know about a recent article on perforated batons. I and many of us fans, I'm sure, would love a video of you exploring this possible solution to the perforated batons mystery. Cheers, Victor. You are absolutely right, Victor. It's a great topic. So huge shout out to you for emailing me. Honestly, I know a bunch of you guys do all the time, and you're all a bunch of legends. Rope making in the Aurignacian of Central Europe more than 35,000 years ago. This new paper came out in January, and it's a really great study. I had to email one of the authors of the paper, Professor Nicholas Conard, right away to get to the bottom of this.
So where I am in Germany, you know, I can look out my window and look into the Neckar Valley. And for me, it's super easy to imagine, you know, the woolly mammoths and woolly rhinos and the lions and just everything happening out there, how people were getting their stone artifacts, making them, how you would survive in the ice age or in a warm period. And all of those things, to me, seem relevant. It seems like part of our history.
In his paper, co-authored with Veerle Rots, Nicholas describes this really interesting baton excavated from Hohle Fels. Situated in southern Germany, Hohle Fels is one of the most incredible Paleolithic sites in all of Europe, probably all of the world, in fact. Archaeologists have recovered female figurines, musical instruments, mysterious oblong artifacts whose use escapes us, all sorts of incredible relics of Paleolithic life, and Nicholas has been there for a lot of it. Southern Germany, in particular, is just a fantastic place to study the Paleolithic. So many great finds. Lion Man was from there too, and this baton is another incredible find as well.
August 15th, 2015, we found it, and the pieces were, there were 13 pieces lying next to each other. It had to be glued back together, but it was largely intact and crushed in place. And it was by far the best preserved ivory perforated baton we've ever found, or that's ever been found anywhere.
Perforated batons are typically made out of deer antler. I have an antler lying around actually. Yeah, so a perforated baton is typically made out of a piece of antler like this. Drill a hole somewhere around here, maybe where the antler branches out even more.
And for the first time, we found a really beautifully preserved perforated baton made from mammoth ivory. And that got my attention. I called Veerle Rots, who is my partner for use wear and studies of residue sticking to tools. And one main question we had, well, first we have a description of the piece, but what was it used for?
Guys, I enjoy imagining life in the Paleolithic, but I don't want to smell like life in the Paleolithic. Just want to say thanks to Scentbird for sponsoring this video. Scentbird, for those who don't know, is a monthly subscription service for cologne, perfumes, fragrances. They send you about 30 days supply of the cologne. Now, my experience shopping for cologne is basically buy a large bottle for too much money and then use it for the next 18 months and smell exactly the same every day. And I don't love that. I would like to be a guy who can sort of smell good, can, you know, mix it up for the occasion or what have you. This one is Rocker Elysium. Let's give it a go. This one I like. This one is kind of citrusy and peppery is the notes. Very summery, very tennis club. Smells like I just smashed Charles in three straight sets. This is another one I really like, Padre. my Milo. Obviously, I am a dad, so I love anything dad-coded. This one's manly. Leather and sandalwood. Smells like I could tame a horse. I can't, but now I could smell like I can. The lion man in the Paleolithic? This is what they would be wearing, okay? That's a manly smell. If you're interested in trying Scentbird, scan the QR code or use the link below, and with my coupon code STEFAN, you'll get 55% off at Scentbird, plus you'll get free delivery to your door and a free case. Just $8 for cologne. That's a great deal. That's a bargain. That's a steal. Huge thanks to Scentbird for sponsoring this video. Back to these batons. Were they cologne dispensers? Probably not. In the past, perforated batons were often interpreted as ritual objects because their use isn't immediately obvious, unlike an axe or something, right? It doesn't immediately jump out to you what this thing could be used for. Some archaeologists in the past wondered if they were like a badge of office.
For instance, Gustav Fricke at the nearby site of Geisenklöster found one with two holes, and he said it was a gorget, right?
A gorget was a piece of medieval armor that went around your neck, but over time, as the medieval battlefield went away and the medieval knight was replaced by early modern armies and guns and things like that, the gorget gradually became this like regimental badge, this symbol. Here's actually a picture of George Washington wearing one. Here, George Washington, in his rather dashing British military uniform, wearing a gorget.
But, you know, that's a pretty big stretch to go from the Napoleonic Wars to 40,000 years ago.
That opinion, I don't know how common it is, but to be honest, Nicholas and most archaeologists, it seems nowadays, believe that this object was practical.
And the other explanations of, you know, a symbol of power, yeah, I can't really get too far with that. And one thing Veerle and I both thought was that it looked much more like a high-tech tool than a symbol of power or an artwork. So we were both on the same page. This is probably something practical.
One of the really interesting features of this baton from Hohle Fels, if I pull it up here, is that it has four holes, which is quite rare. Often one or two is much more common. And they also have these spirals engraved around the holes. To Nicholas and Veerle, this is a big clue to their function.
Veerle Rots and I both thought, well, this is used for something. And we thought with the spirals and the holes, it had to have something to do with feeding something through the hole and pulling it out the other side. And the grooves in these beautiful spirals, yeah, we came to the conclusion we're probably to orient whatever you're putting through the hole and rotate it and put some sort of twist on it. And there aren't that many things you could put through a hole. And we pretty quickly came upon the idea that maybe if you put plant fibers or some elongated fibers through it and they get twisted, that you might be able to use it to make twine or rope or combine small pieces of rope to make big pieces of rope.
Veerle and her team analyzed all the nooks and crannies of this artifact. They never cleaned them 100% because that information is so valuable, right? The dirt and grime inside them is so valuable. They found tiny microscopic fragments of plant fibers. These obviously could have been introduced by the dirt, so they tested the sediment that was recovered from around the object as well. And they found much more plant fibers inside this object than from the sediment just around it. So that is a positive piece of evidence that plant fibers were connected to this object in some way. The only thing left to do really was make a replica and give it a go.
And they keep twisting, and then the person holding the baton just keeps pushing it. And the stuff, and it sticks together. You have to tie off where Grizzly, his name's Christian, nickname Grizzly, and if you tie that off and keep pushing, it just twists up together. And if everyone twists, and at the same time the one guy's holding it and pushing it forward and tying off the end, you can make, you know, just regular people who don't do this every day can make 5 meters a very strong rope in about 10 minutes. So you can.
Oh, wow. That's very quick, actually.
Yeah.
Quicker than I thought.
No, you can see in the video, it's not that hard, and the rope's super strong.
Now, does this prove definitively that perforated batons are rope-making tools? Probably not. Probably not. And that's not the argument that Nicholas and Verla are making. They are simply saying that this particular baton is very good at making rope. If Paleolithic people needed a tool to help them make rope, this would be an excellent option. Some perforated batons found in Britain from a site called Gough's Cave, these only had one hole, which, as I said, is much more typical, but they also had the spiraling grooves around them. And it seems like they were broken under a lot of stress, a lot of pressure. Again, that to me suggests that they could be involved in rope making in some way. Something is putting a lot of strain on these objects.
If you count, I haven't done it, but I know there are a lot of perforated batons. We're not talking about, you know, 10 or 20, we're talking about hundreds. And so these are things that pop up across Europe in many contexts, in the Aurignacian, in the Gravettian, in the Magdalenian, and it's not chance. They were definitely good for something.
There's another really interesting example of perforated batons from Italy. They were found in the grave of a young chap archaeologists call Il Principe, the prince, because he was buried with a huge amount of artifacts for the time. This chap was laid to rest with an elaborately napped flint blade, shells either braided into his hair or perhaps worn as some sort of cap, and four perforated batons. Again, it's so hard to say for sure, but I really wanted to ask Nicholas what he thought of this burial. As I studied it a lot, I know many of you have seen the video on it already. I had to ask him what he thought of this burial with these four batons.
Do you think that their inclusion in at least some burials suggests that these are in some way important?
I think the answer to that question, some way important, definitely.
Yeah.
I'm a little hesitant to say, well, the Paleolithic grave is just like in ancient Egypt where you get on your ship of the dead and you need everything that you need in regular life for the other side. Uh-huh. In the nether world or wherever you go when you die, I'm a little hesitant to go that far with it, but I can certainly imagine that if you find a burial associated with multiple perforated batons, well, one, that's kind of intriguing to find a group of perforated batons. That sort of suggests maybe you don't only just use one at a time. And it suggests that whatever they're good for is something you might want to have with you wherever you're going, right? And if you find hunting equipment, then maybe wherever you're going, you might need to be hunting, or maybe you'll need some rope down the line, or whatever these tools were used for. Maybe if you find equipment for a certain task, whether it's rope making, hunting, or something else, maybe the person used to do this regularly in her or his own life.
One interesting question to ponder is, what were they using these ropes for? I'm sure if you're outdoorsy, like me, I'm basically Tarzan, basically. I only come inside the house to film videos, otherwise I'm just in the woods 24/7. But, not really. But I'm sure if you're outdoorsy, you can think of 100 reasons why you would need rope.
More snow is cut to cover the trap.
Traps, fishing nets, clothing, shelter, transport. Having a strong rope could have made their lives easy in so many ways. One idea I had whilst I was thinking about this after I spoke to Nicholas was connected to moving food, right? The baton from Hohle Fels is made from ivory. These people are living in the Ice Age. There's mammoths around, there's woolly rhinos around. They are killing, hunting, eating these huge animals. How do you get that much food home? Let's say you've killed a mammoth a mile from your house. Are you going to go back to that one spot to get food every time you need it? You're probably not. You're probably going to butcher it and move it closer to where you're staying. So I had a little Google search for modern hunting groups that were still catching huge animals, right?
and I came across this super interesting picture from the turn of the last century of a family of Inuit people moving a walrus, probably in a relatively similar environment to how the people in Hohle Fels were living, very cold, dry landscape. Obviously in Germany, they're not living close to sea ice, but still, moving this walrus is clearly a whole family affair. Dragging it, using these ropes, back to their village, I can't help but imagine were Paleolithic people doing something similar when they hunted a mammoth, a rhino, a reindeer. You've got to get it home somehow. These are big animals. Maybe they didn't drag an entire mammoth, obviously, but can one person pick up a mammoth's leg, an elephant's leg, and carry it a mile or so, a couple of miles? Probably not. I think not. I don't think I could. I think I'd much rather tie a rope around it and get my kids to help drag it. I don't know. It's just an idea. I have no way of proving it. These are just hypotheses, right? It's very difficult to rewind the clock 35,000 years and speak with confidence about anything that was happening. But if people in Paleolithic Europe needed a strong rope and they needed a tool to help them make a strong rope, this perforated baton from Hohle Fels would be an excellent tool to do that. And probably other perforated batons found across Europe would also be an excellent tool. You know, considering the length of time that they were used for, tens of thousands of years, if they had a specific ritual function, that would be a long time to perpetuate a specific ritual. It seems more likely that it would have a practical purpose. But who knows? Who knows? It was a very long time ago, and humans are exceptionally creative. I'm sure if we could rewind the clock, we'd be absolutely amazed at what people in the Paleolithic were up to.
I always think of this quote from John Shea at Stony Brook. He always said, the easiest way to be wrong about our Paleolithic ancestors is to underestimate them.
Hey everyone, thanks for watching. Hope you found it interesting. Huge shout out to Nicholas for taking part and his time. I just wanted to point out, I am aware of the contradiction. In my last video, I argue in favor of a Neanderthal ritual site, and this time I argue against ritual and favor a practical interpretation. It's the dichotomy of man. I can't help it. Sometimes we make a cheese sandwich, sometimes we build the Taj Mahal. It's just our biggest contradiction. I can't help it.